Hello everyone, and welcome to my show, FitLife, Healthy Mind and Body. My name is Natalia Kotowska, and I will be your host. This is UK Health Radio, the world's number one talk health radio. With over 13 years of international experience in sport and fitness, years of studies, I would like to share my experience, knowledge, and most importantly, my endless love and passion for living a healthy lifestyle for my mental and physical well-being. On this show, we will be talking about fitness, sport, healthy living, nutrition, fitness fads, and more. We will be answering your questions. We will have guest speakers. Are you ready? Then let's go! Today we will talk about how the neurological conditions affect our physical and mental health. A neurological disability is a brain-based disorder that impairs the way a person's mind interprets his or her surroundings or how he or she interacts with others. This can lead to secondary conditions, especially of the mental health variety, such as anxiety and depression. These conditions can be treated with appropriate medication and therapies. Neurological conditions can be a lot of things. It's a blanket term for problems with the brain and the nervous system. They affect different parts of your mental health, from feeling angry or sad to being physically overwhelmed. Neurological condition isn't diagnosis. It is description of what is going on. It might be caused by a problem in your mind, in your brain, or it might be down to something else affecting your brain. There are a number of neurological disorders that have an impact on a person's mental health. Today, we are speaking to Tina, the director of Speech Therapy Interactive and a specialist speech and language therapies. She works with adults who have communication and swallowing difficulties as a result of an acquired or progressive neurological conditions, such as stroke, brain injury, dementia, and more. She focuses on patient goals using a holistic approach, improving their psychological well-being and quality of life. Alongside this, she is also an advocate for her patients assisting in mental capacity assessments and providing education and training for health professionals to provide effective care for their patients. Tina, welcome to the show.
UK Health Radio,
the station that makes you feel good.
Radio,
the station that makes you feel good.
Good morning.
Morning.
Oh, hello, hello. I thought I couldn't hear you, but I can hear you now. How are you, Tina?
I'm very well, thank you. How are you?
I'm good. I'm good. Glad to have you. Thank you for making the time, and good morning. Welcome to UK Health Radio.
Thank you. Thank you very much for having me.
No problem. My pleasure. All right. So let's start. UK Health Radio, healthy mind, healthy body. Thank you for accepting the invitation and welcome. Tina, today we have a great topic about how the neurological conditions affect our physical and mental health. Mm-hmm. So yeah. You're the specialist today. So I would like to know more about you and your work, your business. What are you all about?
Sure. So morning, everybody. My name is Tina. I'm a specialist multilingual speech and language therapist. So I have worked 10 years for the NHS, and in lockdown, I became a first-time mum to my gorgeous son, Arian. That's when I decided to work for myself, setting up my own practice, allowing me that flexibility so I can be there for my son's drop-offs, pickups, sports day, everything really, but also allowing me the choice to provide quality client care. So now I'm the founder of Speech Therapy Interactive. I work with adults in the community with different types of communication and swallowing difficulties as a result of an acquired or progressive neurological condition. So my role involves assessing and providing personalized client-centered therapy, not just in English, but also in Punjabi and in Urdu in East London and Essex. I'm really, really proud of my practice. It's only been running for 1 year, and recently I've been awarded by ASLTIP, which is the Association of Speech and Language Therapy Independent Practice, for the best startup for the independent SLT practice. So I'm really, really proud of that.
Well done. Congratulations. It sounds great.
Thank you. Thank
you. So you just had your first child. How exciting is that during the COVID, you're saying?
Yes, definitely has been a bit of a roller coaster, but I would not change it for the world. It's been a blessing as well.
I believe you. You know, this COVID, I guess, showed us so many different things about ourselves. So, you know, some people realize, oh, actually, I can work from home and that's not so bad. Some people are like, oh, I hate working from home, or several different things, you know, like with you getting pregnant, being a mom, with me perhaps showing me that I need to also think of how to survive when the world is stopping, you know, how to, exactly like you said, setting your own thing so you can maintain, manage and control your life.
Absolutely. I mean, it's definitely changed a bit of way of working as well. So as well as seeing my clients face to face, I now have the opportunity of providing those that can't see me face to face with teletherapy. So it's definitely opened a lot of doors.
Right. So tell me more about where the love for this specific, very specific career came from.
Yeah. So I originally wanted to be a psychologist. Right. So I completed my BSc in psychology and an MSc in health psychology. My dissertation was actually published into a book called The Best of Both Worlds. But unfortunately, after my father had a stroke, I changed my career pathway, working in hospitals and neurorehabilitation settings. So my father had a stroke when he was 32.
Oh, wow.
At a very young age. And it really turned his and our lives completely upside down as a family as well. I specifically remember an event which still brings water to my eyes. After he was discharged from the hospital, he started carrying out his normal activities of daily living. He went out to go and get some groceries, and while walking, he stopped in the middle of the street in great panic. He didn't know where he was, and he didn't know how to get home. Yeah, it was very, very sad. But, you know, with time and with the help of his support network, which included the medical team, therapists, and most importantly, his family, he got through the tough times. And we as a family felt very supported by the whole multidisciplinary team. So I wanted to do that for others. For me, when I see my patients or clients, I see them as a person. The care I provide for them is nothing less than what I would expect for my if they were my father or my mother, my brother, my grandparents, friends, or even my child. So it's no surprise that I have a lot of love for them. They become part of my family, and not just them, but their families too.
Wow. How's your dad right now?
Yes, he's doing so, so well. He's returned back to work. He's actually working for the NHS as well. He manages biomedical engineers. He's doing ever so well, and he's just so supported by his family, with his work colleagues. And I think that's really, really important to keep his confidence and motivation keep going.
Has he fully recovered, or is he still facing some form of difficulties?
I think in terms of from a physical point of view, he has recovered. But in terms of psychological well-being, I mean, it's quite a traumatic event. It almost kind of leaves a bit of a scar, doesn't it? So time to time, there are some things that he finds difficult, but he's quite a positive being. He's very optimistic about life. And I think that's where I get my optimism from as well. So he keeps persevering through the challenges, really.
So would you say, looking at your dad journey and health situation, that was your biggest motivation, inspiration?
Yes, definitely. Seeing my father go through that major life event and seeing how it affected our family, and with the support, how he recovered and was able to integrate back into the community and do things that he was, you know, doing before, was definitely such a big, massive reward and satisfaction. And that really, truly inspired me. I said, oh, I would really love to do that for other people as well.
Fantastic. I mean, how traumatic experiences can turn into something beautiful, isn't it? It's sometimes we look at things, that's why we cannot take anything for granted. At the beginning, it might look tragic, but then within the time, we start to see the lesson and the blessing in every situation. So, you know, from such a traumatic situation, something beautiful happen.
Absolutely. I think that's the biggest thing is, you know, there are lots of things that happen in life. We go through lots of ups and downs, but that is life. I mean, even within an ECG, it's not a straight line, is it? It goes up and down, and that kind of shows us that we're living. So
speaking about your job, could you tell us what are the neurological conditions? Can you explain more? Because I must say, for me, it's still a little bit like black magic. What is this all about?
Sure. So neurological disorders, they're medically defined as disorders that can affect the brain, as well as the nerves found throughout the human body and the spinal cord. So it could be a structural, biochemical, or electrical abnormality in the brain, spinal cord, or other nerves, and which can result into a range of symptoms. So if we think of neurological conditions, they can be broadly categorized into sudden onsets, like acquired brain injuries or strokes. They could be unpredictable onsets, such as epilepsy or early stages of multiple sclerosis. Or you can even have progressive neurological conditions, such as dementia and Parkinson's.
Okay, so how this can impact someone's communication?
Yeah, so in terms of communication disorders, there are a variety of communication difficulties one can have. I will go through a few with you. So some people, after having a stroke, can have something called an aphasia. An aphasia is a language disorder which can affect one's understanding. So some people with aphasia might not be able to follow directions or instructions. Some might not be able to understand conversations. It can also affect your talking, which can vary for someone not having any verbal output, or others might not be able to say words, single words, or some might be able to say single words, but not phrases or sentences, or others might not be able to say anything at all, but just vocalize sound. You can have things like word finding difficulties, so having difficulty with getting the right words out. It can affect your reading. It can affect your writing. You can also have something like a dysarthria. So if you've had a stroke or a progressive neurological condition like Parkinson's, you can have weakness in the muscles of the face, mouth, as well as your breathing system can be affected, where the person's speech may lack clarity, sounding slurred or slow. If you've had a stroke, you can have something like an apraxia of speech, which means that the brain is having difficulty with planning and coordinating movements in the muscles of the face, mouth, and voice box, which can make it very difficult to speak clearly. The muscles might not be weak, but the person can't coordinate the muscle movements in a complex sequence, which is needed for speech. With brain injury, or if you had dementia, You could also have cognitive communication difficulties, so difficulties with attention, memory, problem solving, planning, sequencing, your executive functioning skills, which can have a major impact on your communication. But it's not just about communication. Your swallowing can also be affected. So as a result of a neurological condition, your muscles that are responsible for eating and drinking might not be working effectively or efficiently, increasing that risk of penetration and aspiration. So if you think of your food pipe, it's right next to your windpipe. If your muscles are weak or not working as they should, food and drink can go down the wrong way. So into your windpipe instead of your food pipe, down into your chest instead of your stomach, and give you a chest infection like aspiration pneumonia, which can be very, very fatal. So these are a few.
Sounds very, I would say, complicated to me, but at the same time, scary, you know, because you think, I've heard several cases when people actually unfortunately die because they just didn't swallow properly. And I was thinking to myself, wow, how is that even possible? But from what you're explaining, it's actually very possible.
Yeah, I mean, it can very, very, it can range from a variety depending on the level of impairment, I guess, the severity of it. If it's a quite severe brain injury or a stroke that you've had, or even in terms of a progressive neurological condition, if you're at the end stages, it can really have a big, massive impact on your physical health.
Right. Do you think those problems that we're speaking about are caused by our physical disability? Are they also connected with our mental health?
I would say a bit of both, to be honest. Yeah, definitely. It's not just your physical health you're looking at. If you have to look at a person holistically as a whole person, it's not just the physical health, but the mental and psychological well-being that's being affected as well. And that goes hand in hand.
So how do you help people? If you can describe the whole process, if, you know, if someone wants to be your client, is your client, how does it look like from the starting point?
Sure. So I help my clients with communication difficulties by improving their ability to communicate so they can express their needs, wants, preferences, opinions, and make decisions. So initially I carry out an assessment, and it can either be in English, Hindi, Punjabi, or Urdu, dependent on the client's language, to get to the bottom of what type of communication difficulty they are having so that I can provide the kind of therapy that will be best for them. So I work on impairment-based therapy, which is targeting the impairment of the communication disorder. And this might include exercises or an intensive one-to-one program. But most importantly, I like to work using functional-based therapy as well, integrating them back into the community, improving their quality of life and psychological well-being. As you can imagine, having a communication difficulty can have a profound effect on one's well-being and mental health. There are many different approaches I take, depending on the nature of the disorder, and look at the clients holistically, viewing them as a person. For me, speech and language therapy is more than words. It's about the actions, choices, and independence that I want to pass on to my clients every single day. I believe that confidence plays such an important role in a person's ability to communicate. So I help my patients build that confidence so they're able to join in conversations, talk to new people, and do the things that they want to do. I also involve friends and families. So like I said, I carry a mixture of either face-to-face or teletherapy as preferred by the client. And I educate and provide training regarding compensatory or coping strategies to families, looking at alternative methods of communication, so such as communication aids, charts, books or apps, using a total communication approach. I think working with the client's support network is very, very important. If my clients are learning a new way to communicate, then the people around them, they need to learn as well. So I encourage my clients' family, friends, and carers to attend the speech and language therapy sessions with the patients, and then they can practice strategies and therapy at home with them. as well as communication, I work with clients with swallowing difficulties. So this might be rehabilitation exercises, maneuvers, strategies. I might look into modifying their diet and fluid consistencies so they're not at risk of aspiration pneumonia. Also having difficult conversations sometimes for some of my clients, especially those with progressive neurological conditions, where their swallows may deteriorate or their swallow function may not recover. So they might need to think of alternatives such as a PEG, which is a feeding tube in the stomach. Or it might be my 90-year-old who says, no, I don't want to have a PEG. I want to risk feed, accepting the risks of eating and drinking for the remaining quality of life that she has. Another role that I play is advocating for my clients, assisting them in mental capacity assessments. So only because they have a communication difficulty or a neurological condition does not mean that they do not have capacity to make a decision. Some of my clients may not have the capacity to make complex decisions, but have the capacity to make decisions regarding what they want to eat and drink or what they want to wear or where they want to go. So yeah, a lot of things I tend to cover.
I can tell. So would you say, what is the age group of your clients mainly? Do you work with children as well as adults? Does it happen in all ages stages, or is it defined perhaps by the age group?
Sure. In terms of who I work with adults. And when you think about adults, it can happen to anyone, really. I mean, my father had a stroke at 32. That was quite young. I have a client who's had a road traffic accident, and as a result of that, he's got a brain injury and he's only 21. So it's not just the thinking isn't, you know, as you get older, when you become elderly, that's when you have these problems. It can really happen to anyone at any point.
Scary, isn't it? Can you be born with those difficulties or disabilities, if I can call it this way?
Yeah, so I'm not a medical expert. That's more of a doctor's role. But yes, you can have be born with possibly a neurological condition, which can have an effect on your development physically, as well as your cognition and communication as well, and your eating and drinking as you get older.
So, you know, when you see individuals going through those struggles, and then you connect with their families and you see the families, do you see also how much work the family as a unit has to put in order to deal with that matter? Do you see them also struggling, perhaps emotionally, mentally?
Absolutely. I mean, it's a big, massive change for the whole family, not just the person who's got the neurological condition. It can really have a massive impact on the family's mental well-being as well. So for some of my patients, they've now, with their stroke or their brain injury, it's affected their quality of life and activities of daily living, but it's also affected their families, in where there's been either a role reversal, or either they now feel that they're that their loved one's carers rather than, I don't know, their wife or their child.
And so how to think the neurological condition affects someone apart from mentally, emotionally, physically as well, apart from their speaking issues, swallowing, is there anything else in the body that this could affect?
Yes, the neurological conditions can have a huge impact in different ways for different people with regards to their physical and mental health. So I'll specifically today talk to you about my stroke clients and take them as an example. With regards to their physical health, it can affect one's mobility, their ability to sit, stand or walk. They might require a wheelchair now or might need an aid to help them, like a Zimmer frame or walking stick. They could even be bedbound. It can even affect your upper limbs. So because of the stroke, they may not be able to use their preferred hand due to weakness or paralysis. So might have difficulties with feeding themselves, washing and dressing themselves, getting changed, toileting. They might have gross motor skills like picking up a glass of water, but the fine motor skills can be affected, such as doing the buttons on their shirt or writing their shopping list or filling a form, carrying change. Their coordination can be affected. Their vision can be affected, where they might have neglect to their right or left side, or have a hemianopia, which is where the periphery vision may be affected. So that can impact your safety in terms of crossing the road. Your cognition can be affected, where you might find it difficult now to return to work, or might need support with activities of daily living tasks, such as finances, shopping, planning, problem solving. So if you think of going to the shops, being able to give the right money, getting the right change, what to do if you were at home alone in an emergency. As I've spoken about communication difficulties as well, but if you see the functional aspects of it, is things like, for example, if your reading was affected, are you able to read your medication label? Are you able to read the food menus at the restaurant? If your understanding is affected, are you able to participate in group discussions when you have family gatherings over the dining table? You know, it can have a really profound impact on the client and the family's well-being, where the client or patient may feel grief and loss after a stroke. Like I said, it's such a major life event for many people. It leads to sudden change at home, work, in relationships. You know, I've got many South Asian families that I deal with where the husband used to be the breadwinner or earns more money than their partner. And all of a sudden, he's had a stroke, and that's led to financial stress in the family. As I mentioned before, there's been a role reversal or loss of relationships, where family members are now feeling that they are their loved one's carers as opposed to their wife or child. It can really affect the person with the stroke, their confidence, so the loss of confidence. Mm-hmm. They might find it difficult to cope with their emotions, feeling angry. They may get angry more often after they've had a stroke. And it can be linked to many things, you know, including their feelings of grief, loss and frustration about the stroke. It can be linked with changes in the brain, making it hard for them to control their emotions. They could feel frustrated, not being able to do the things that they were able to do, or if things are taking longer now, not being able to find the right words. They might feel anxious, you know, fear of having another stroke, panic attacks, even low mood and feeling depressed, feeling sadness about the stroke and the changes it's had in their lives. For all these reasons, I really, really feel it's important for therapists, whether it's a speech and language therapist, an occupational therapist, or a physiotherapist, or even the medical team, to work collaboratively together using a holistic approach, where they're viewing their patients or clients as a whole person, providing them with adequate support, as well as working, as you know, we're all working on the same goals, which is improving the quality of life and psychological well-being of the patient. So if you think of a client or a patient, if they're in low mood or they're depressed, they're not going to be motivated to take part in therapy and reach their potential. And motivation is so key for rehab, not only supporting the clients, but their families need support as well. You know, we only see the clients for an hour and then we go home. The families are there for the whole time, supporting their loved ones, implementing the advice, strategies, exercises given by the therapists or the medical team to ensure that consistency. So we're seeing the client, but we're also seeing their families too. And that's really important to be able to provide support for both of them as a whole, I guess.
Yeah, I cannot imagine what the family is going through in situations like this, because, you know, apart from, like you just mentioned, the person who struggled with that must be a tragic change, but the family is also extremely overwhelmed, so it's extremely important to support them mentally as well as physically. Does that person need actually like 24/7 healthcare as well, or family is taking over?
Yeah, so I guess it's really dependent on each family dynamic, and obviously dependent on the severity of the condition as well. So some of my clients who are bedbound might need 24-hour care, And that care, again, discussing with the family members and the social workers, they'll be able to best advise in terms of how much input they can give and how much the family would like to take over as well. And there are lots of other support groups out there where families can get access to, as well as the patients and the clients who are going through this change, speaking to other family members who are in the same situation. So having that network is very important, and having that support is quite nice as well, because, you know, you can almost relate and resonate with the other person, as well as, you know, having that access to support groups outside there. There's a lot of organizations and charities that provide a lot of support as well for families, and things like respite care, where the family members can have a bit of a break and focus on themselves as well, because that's equally as important in terms of their mental well-being. So there's a lot of things to think about for sure, but there is a lot of support out there to help family members and the patient going through this huge change.
Yeah, sounds really serious, and sounds really, I would say a lot of sacrifices needs to be done in order to help that person as well as the family. So it's crucial to, I guess, be patient and very consistent with the work, isn't it?
Yeah, I mean, I went through it with my family, so I know I can really resonate with my patients and their family members of how life-changing it can be. And, you know, you don't expect it. It happens all of a sudden, and it's a big massive shock for the patient, but as well as the family members. And it's something completely new for them, and they have to almost learn new ways of working together and supporting each other as a family, and that in itself can be quite tricky.
Well, thank you so much for sharing your expertise and your knowledge. I think it's important to approach different subjects in order to understand how many difficulties we can face in life and what type of, you know, physical and mental health issues we can face on daily basis from different angles. So thank you for that.
You're very welcome. Thank you so much for having me on today. I really appreciate it. And I hope that whatever I've shared has been helpful for other people.
Of course, it's spreading awareness, spreading knowledge, you know, love, educating people. It's important to be aware of what's out there, what we should pay attention to and be sensitive about. So thank you again, and I wish you a lovely day. And thank you for accepting the invitation one more time.
Thank you. Thank you so much. Well, I hope you have a lovely day as well. Enjoy the rest of your day.
Thank you, Tina. You too. Bye-bye.
Bye-bye.
And now it's time for our workout team. But before we do it, here are some valuable information from our station sponsors.
UK Health Radio.
The station that makes you feel good.
Radio.
The station that makes you feel good.
All right, team. So the weather is so beautiful out there, and I'm sure majority of you don't want to be stuck inside the building, gym, or house and do their workout. No problem. The most important thing in working out or taking care of your physical health is just to be active. It doesn't always have to be 100 miles an hour running and spinning and doing crazy things or even doing certain exercises. Sometimes it's good to take care of your physical health while looking after your mental well-being, which can include go for a nice long walk. If you see the sun is shining and you just finish your work, instead of taking a bus or tube, just take a walk. Even if it's 2 or 3 miles, it's better to walk with your normal tempo, gather your thoughts, organize your brain, organize your thinking, and still actually working on your fitness health, fitness well-being. So why not walk instead of taking a public transport? or even a car. Or maybe there is an option for you to change public transport for a bicycle. For example, I live quite far away from train station. So if I want to get to the city, I need to go to a train station. In order to do that, I have to take a bus. But if I wanted to get a little bit more of physical activity in, I'm going to cycle 2 miles to the train station, leave the bicycle by the train station, and then I can take a train. That is a solution. So what I wanted to highlight here is that you don't have to always get your fitness on while by being at the gym or working out. You can actually take care of your physical well-being by doing something very basic, like walk, like jog, like just go out there and enjoy the sunshine and maybe do a few push-ups. If you're sitting on the bench in the park, why not do some tricep dips? Why not just stretch? You know, simple solutions sometimes are very essential and just much needed. So I would encourage you to think what you can replace in your daily routine in order to take care of more about your physical health. And now this is for all levels. Anyone can do it. Trust me, I'm very fit. But there are moments when that fitness doesn't help my mental health. That is something separate. And sometimes I need to take it back, take it to the basic, which is simple walk. Just simple walk home, jog home, or just have a sit in the park. Relax, look at the birds, look at the trees, just keep breathing. Practice your breathing, because we're so caught up in that crazy fast world, fast pace, that we forget about something that is the most important, which is breathing. I do that. I can admit that. I forget to focus on the right deep breathing to calm my brain, to calm my breathing, to just help me organize my thoughts and have more clarity in my head what to do next. I'm not gonna lie to you, team. Like, there are moments when I don't feel like working out at all. And those are the moments when you need to really listen to your body and think, what do I need right now? Maybe I need some rest. But in order to rest, you need to have that acceptance and allow it to happen. So I need to work on the very different things that some of you might work on. I need to sometimes work to calm down and just take the step back. Some of you perhaps need more push to go out there and do something more. But we always need to stay very much in tune with our own inner being and listen to the voice, our bodies. What does it tell us today? And because the weather is so beautiful right now, and we in spring, getting into summer, I would still encourage you, instead of just being passive while you're in the park, go on a bench, do some hip dips or tricep dips, push-ups, or just sit and enjoy the breathing. That breathing will also help your metabolism. Being outdoor will help your metabolism. And metabolism is something extremely important for our calorie burn. So think about those basic solutions and let me know how you do. If you need any help, if you need any nutritional advices or any exercises, like if you have any disabilities or problems or dysfunctions, you can always message me and let me know how is it going. Let me know how you're feeling. Don't be afraid to ask questions. Don't be afraid to open dialogue. I'm always here for you. It can happen in a very private manner. So I encourage you to just reach out. I'm here for you. Thank you for today, and I will see you next time. Understanding how a person's neurological condition can impact their mental health is the first step in helping them re-establish healthy habits. Understanding how their mental health can affect them physically, it's also important. so they can manage their symptoms appropriately. And finally, understanding their interactions of these two systems helps you to be an effective advocate for your loved ones when they need help from others, such as physicians or psychiatrists. I hope you enjoyed today's episode, as well as our short workout together. Share with me your thoughts, comments, DM me with your life stories. And if you have any questions or you would like me to talk about any particular subject, please contact me. You can follow me on Instagram, fitnesswithnk, or you can DM me and leave your message. And make sure you visit my website, www.nataliakotowska.com, for more information. Thank you very much for tuning in. Thank you for listening, and I will see you next time.